Final game that we're talking about is number 7 Texas at Iowa State, 8 p.m. Eastern time on Fox. The storyline, biggest storyline is clearly, what does Texas's offense look like without its superstar? Because right when Quinn Ewers got back from a shoulder injury, they suffered another devastating blow. This one probably even more devastating, in that Jonathon Brooks, star running back, tore his ACL against TCU. He will miss the remainder of the season, obviously. Before the ACL tear, he was the number 1 running back prospect on PFF's big board for the NFL draft. He also had the 4th most yards after contact in the FBS, and he had the most forced missed tackles this year among Power 5 running backs. Even after losing Bijan Robinson and Roschon Johnson, they still have a star running back in Jonathon Brooks, who unfortunately suffered that torn ACL. We'll see if he even enters the draft now, because now he wouldn't be able to do any of the pre-draft stuff like the combine, like any of the all-star games that are now allowing juniors to participate, so he would be allowed to participate. We'll see what he does after the season's over, what he decides to do, but it was a brutal blow for not only him and his draft stock, but for Texas's offense. Now you got C.J. Baxter, who's a true freshman, starting in his absence. He was the number 1 running back recruit in the 2023 class, but still, man, it is really hard to fill those massive shoes left behind by Jonathon Brooks.
Yeah, and you wonder, and Baxter's a good player. He's played well.
Yeah.
I'm not going to, you know, a big 54-yard run, I believe it was, against Kansas State, one of the biggest plays of that game. It is a major question, because Quinn Ewers, outside the Alabama game, it's still been up and down, right? And his, you know, everything really on their offense was based on, the most effective parts of it at least, was Brooks and play action, right? But non-play action passing, just drop back passing. Quinn Ewers has a 64.2 passing grade. They really, and it shouldn't be that way. Adonai Mitchell and Whittington, right? And Jatavius Sanders, like, they've got so many weapons. You would think that they could just drop back and throw the ball like these other teams and get after it. And it just doesn't quite work for them. Jonathon Brooks is the heart and soul and engine of everything of this offense. Like, this is as bad an injury that a team in the country, to a non-quarterback, as any team could have.
Yeah.
I don't think it can be understated how much harder, and I like C.J. Baxter. He's played really well. But is he that guy yet?
Mm-hmm.
This is C.J. Baxter on, I'm guessing, I don't know, 8 to 10 carry, 10 carries a game, maybe,
mm-hmm.
that we've freshman. Seen?
Yeah.
I mean, you could legitimately, especially in this game, hand the ball to Brooks 30 times. And you know what you're getting. And now it's just, I mean, they lost their best player.
Yeah.
And you know, I think going into the season, some people, Quinn Ewers is going to make the jump. And this, no. The reason this Texas offense worked was Jonathon Brooks. And it is the big mystery in this game. Iowa State, look, this is not a team you want to start playing, having to throw the ball against them. This secondary, and Matt Campbell has good secondaries every year and solid pass rushes, but this secondary, TJ Tampa is actually another guy I coached against in St. Pete, Lakewood High School down there. He played ways, corner and receiver. He was a monster in the slot at receiver, to be honest with you. I was almost, when we saw him down at Lakewood, I was a little surprised he went and played corner instead of receiver, but man, oh man, both ways, he was a nightmare. But 8th best coverage grade at corner in the country. Carson Willich and Jeremiah Cooper, both in the top 5 in coverage grade at safety. They got this weird 3 safety, like 3-3 defense that gives teams problems every year. And you know, I mentioned their secondary, man, it's so good. Like, they only allow 57% of passes to be completed. In the Power 5, it's only 3 teams that are better: Florida State, Ohio State, Notre Dame. That's it. Iowa State secondary, this is not the week that you go, oh man, Brooks is out, Quinn, we need you to carry us, man. In Ames, this is not the week that you want to go in now without your best player, especially with it being the running back. And they really, Texas has the advantage in the trenches in this game, but if you don't have Brooks, it's tough. There's big question marks right now with Texas offense, because Ewers isn't the superstar that he's looked like in the 2 Alabama games. And Brooks, he was the heart and soul, man. They're going to have to be scratching and clawing for points in this game.
Yeah, TJ Tampa is the number 41 prospect on PFS Big Board right now. I know Trevor really likes TJ Tampa. I think Connor Rogers also really likes him as well. So, yeah, this is a really good – that was exactly my matchup. You stole it from me, was that can Quinn Ewers step up, man? Because, you know, he has improved his grade from last year. He has an 81.1 grade this year so far, 72.4 a year ago. But he'll likely need to take his game to even further level without Jonathon Brooks now. And he does have one of the best receiving corps in the country. Like I mentioned, Xavier Worthy, Adonai Mitchell, Jordan Whittington, Jatavion Sanders, all the guys, Isaiah Nair, all the guys they have there. And one of the best offensive lines. Texas's offensive line has done an amazing job protecting the quarterback this year. They have been one of the best pass blocking units in the country. But again, Iowa State, I will say, the one thing that Quinn will have is time. Iowa State is not a good pass rushing team at all. They are 113th in the country this year in pass rushing grade. So he will have time back there. But like you mentioned, man, where they do excel is coverage. They have an amazing, amazing secondary with a 9th best coverage grade in the FBS this season with TJ Tampa, those safeties they got there as well. It is going to be tough sledding for Quinn Ewers and a big test for him now without his star running back that they give rely on. Because in so many games, when even Malik Murphy was playing, they were like, okay, Jonathon, just carry us to victory. We need you to carry. We don't have any pass game to speak of right now. We need you to carry us to victory. Texas has the potential to have one of the best passing games in the country. It's just on Quinn Ewers because you got the offensive line that's protecting at an elite rate. You have, I would argue, in terms of talent, might be a top 3 to 5 receiving corps in the country in terms of talent. It's just the quarterback has not delivered the ball consistently. And for Texas to not only win this game, but win the Big 12, and even if they get to the college football playoff, compete for a national championship, they need Quinn Ewers now to step up and be the guy that was the number one overall recruit in his recruiting class and one of the highest rated quarterback recruits ever. They need that guy now. They need that guy to finally step up and for us to see truly if Quinn Ewers is a viable NFL starting quarterback or if he'll return to school next year like a lot of the reports say that he might do. So ultimately, Dalton, who do you have winning in what I think will be a really good Big 12 game?
This is going to be an excellent – this should be an excellent game, and I think in a sense of that these two defenses are going to carry the day. I'm worried about Texas. This actually for me was the hardest game to pick. Yeah. I think there's a lot about Texas we don't know right now. You know, you talk about a team skidding by. Everybody wants to get on Washington and Florida State. Texas is kind of in the same boat. I know right. Last week they took care of business, TCU.
The BTC by 3, though. It was close.
This is going to be tight. This is going to be really, really tight on the road in a low-key, really tough environment. And Matt Campbell, I'm telling you, especially in the secondary, he puts together great defensive game plans, man. Yeah. He's been doing this for years. And I'm shocked still that he doesn't. He's another one. Why Texas A&M wouldn't call him, I have no idea. Matt Campbell's a spectacular coach. I think there's an advantage for Texas in the trenches. On one side, like you mentioned, but Iowa State, their offensive line is the second lowest graded in the Power 5 right now. And Tavondre Sweat and Byron Murphy, for Texas, are the two highest graded defensive tackles in the country. So I Tavondre Sweat was actually the difference in that K-State game. He was the best player on the field. This is going to be ugly. And if for some reason Texas falls behind, they're in major trouble trying to throw into this secondary. But I think in games like this, it usually comes down to like the marginal battle in the trenches. And Texas does have the advantage. They have a decided advantage in both sides on the trenches. And I think Tavondre Sweat's going to be the best player on the field again. This guy, he doesn't have a lot of sacks, but I'll tell you what, he's one of those guys, the impact.
Oh,
it's off the charts. And Murphy, too. I mean, those two guys, I have no answers for how Iowa State's going to block those two guys. This is going to be ugly. This is going to be a fist fight, man. And this is the hardest game to pick. I won't be shocked if Texas loses, but I'm going to take Texas 20-17. It's going to be, this is going to be a war, man, because I believe Iowa State's, are they still alive for the Big 12 title picture too?
I'm not sure. I think right now it's Texas and Oklahoma State are the two. And then Iowa State, yeah, so they're five. Yeah, they're one of the 5-2 teams. So they technically are still alive.
Yeah, they are alive. And obviously there's a lot to shake out in tiebreakers, but you know, look, Iowa State, Texas, K-State next week. You never know. Last home game of the year. This is the one I think is in the most danger of any of the playoff teams of going down. And honestly, I've kind of felt like I've been in this boat where I think Texas is the most likely of those remaining teams to lose a game that's not, obviously Georgia's playing Bama and Ohio State, Michigan, to lose some other game. I don't know that they'll finish this season with just one loss. I'm going to take them in this game and not feel great about it.
Yeah, that's fair. Yeah, dude, if Texas loses, there's a chance Texas might not even play in the Big 12 title game, honestly, which would be crazy. Oof. That's insane, because right now Texas is 6-1 in the conference, and then you got Oklahoma State, Oklahoma, Iowa State, and Kansas State all 5-2 right now. So you got a logjam for that last spot. If Texas loses, though, Iowa State is also 6-2, as is Texas in the conference. Iowa State jumps Texas in terms of that, and then Oklahoma has a tiebreaker over Texas too, because Oklahoma beat Texas.
I think for me, even if they do make it, I would not want that rematch with K-State.
Yeah,
I would not want that at all. Oklahoma, that's weird because it depends which Oklahoma you get. I would not want that rematch with Kansas State if I'm Texas. No way.
I think Oklahoma State probably is the one they probably want the most, because I think that run defense can slow down Ollie Gordon enough. And if you slow down Ollie Gordon, you're winning that game against Oklahoma State.